डॉक्टर मोदी हाय
हाय, कैन यू हियर मी?
या वी कैन हियर यू।
ऑल राइट,
आर यू
इट्स
एबल टू शेयर योर स्क्रीन? डू यू हैव दैट ऑप्शन? राइट,
यस, आई विल बी एबल टू शेयर द स्क्रीन।
या
चेक
नॉट
दैट
नाउ,
वंस।
बट आई विल टेल यू व्हेन यू स्टार्ट योर प्रेजेंटेशन, देन यू कैन शेयर। जस्ट चेक वेदर यू हैव द ऑप्शन और नॉट।
या आई, लेट मी जस्ट चेक।
या श्योर सर।
यप, आई कैन।
या श्योर सर। राइट सर,
ऑल
वी आर
राइट,
स्टार्टिंग इन अ कपल ऑफ मिनट्स,
ऑल
इलेवन
राइट,
टू और सो।
ओके ओके, श्योर।
ओके राइट सर।
Hello, hello all. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes.
Yeah, hello. Hello all. Welcome to this webinar, which is organized by the Center for Predictive Human Model Systems. So the center was actually created under the aegis of Atal Incubation Center, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, Hyderabad, along with the Humane Society International India. It was started last year in the month of June. So the idea behind this center is to promote human relevant non-animal methodologies in clinical and biomedical research. So as a part of that initiative, so we have also started this webinar series where we reach out to people and tell them more about human relevant methodologies in biomedical research and clinical research. So as a part of this, so we invite you all to this webinar. And just a few rules that the participants' video could be on, but ensure that your audio is all time off until you are prompted to do so. And we have three speakers for today, Dr. Surat, Dr. Karishma Kaushik, and Dr. Deepak Modi. I welcome them all to this webinar. And so let's start the with no further ado, let's start the webinar. So now I invite Dr. Surat to turn on her video and as well start her presentation. Before that, I would just like to mention regarding the Q&As, a question and answer. If right after the speaker's presentation, if there are any questions, I would request all of you to type in your questions in the chat box in the Zoom chat as well as Facebook Live, Facebook comments. So on both these platforms, the participants can type in their questions, and all those questions will be addressed at the end of the seminar when all the three speakers are done with their presentations. So hence, I request now Dr. Surat to turn on her screen sharing and start the presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Sham, for that. I hope I'm audible. I'll just start sharing my screen. Yeah, so is the screen visible? Sham, can you just unmute yourself and let me know if the screen is visible?
Yes, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So I'm Surat. I'm a senior research associate with the Center for Predictive Human Model Systems, and which was just introduced by Sham. So this is a system that this center was, I don't know, can you see some red marks on it? Or is it only visible on my screen? Okay.
We also can see some red marks.
I don't know. So this center was created in joint collaboration between Atal Incubation Center CCMB and Humane Society International India, and as Sham mentioned, the idea of the center is to establish it as a policy and think tank to enable the shift from animal models towards more human relevant paradigms in both biomedical research and drug discovery. So to start off, I'll start off by talking about why we are talking about human relevant research. So the biomedical research and drug discovery has been driven by animal model research and animal models. And while animal models have given us extremely useful insights, there is also a growing realization that in the end they cannot recapitulate all the complexities of human biology. And as it was eloquently put by Thomas Hartung in a commentary in 2013, where the title of the commentary was, "Humans are not 70 kg mice." So while we may share varying degrees of genetic similarities with various animal models, there are also the differences also account for the huge variabilities that are huge differences that we see in terms of both immune and stress response pathways, and the clinical manifestations of various diseases. And in terms of drug discovery, how a drug is absorbed, distributed, and metabolized in an animal model versus humans. So, and these differences have also contributed to the differences, to the huge difference in efficiency that we see when we translate a target from preclinical stages to finally the clinical trial stages. For example, only 9.6% of the targets that enter the phase one clinical trials after passing the preclinical stages finally enter the market. So you can see that this current paradigm is not a very efficient process. And apart from problem of efficiency, there is also the issue of huge costs which are associated with this paradigm. So currently the average cost of developing a single drug is $2 to $3 billion. And this amount is increasing every year. On the other hand, the number of drugs that are actually approved by FDA every year. So I'm using the data for FDA because that is available publicly and everybody has access to it. So the number of drugs that have been approved by FDA every year. So those numbers have not changed. So while the money which is going in is increasing, but there is no translation in terms of efficiency of the number of targets that are finally approved. So considering these limitations in the current paradigm that we have, several countries across the globe have also started various initiatives to improve the system and make it more relevant to humans rather than make it more relevant to animals. So one of the recent initiative has been by US EPA, which announced last year that it's going to eliminate all mammalian testing by 2035. And it also announced that it is going to reduce funding towards again mammalian testing by 30% by 2025. And similarly, even in India, there have been a few initiatives. For example, there was a recent perspectives paper by Soumya Swaminathan, where she wrote about how we need to shift towards a more human relevant paradigm even in India. And there was also a recent article in Nature which discussed some of the recent initiatives in India towards in this space. So what are the alternatives? Like, if we do need to move towards human relevant methodology, so what are the alternatives that we have? So one of the approaches towards this is microphysiological systems, which are basically a small scale version of the functional unit of an organ or a tissue, which aims to recapitulate the human biology. So this includes both three-dimensional tissues or mini tissues, which are grown in vitro, which are also called organoids. So these are again mini organ-like structures. So the size ranges from 100 microns to few mm. And another such new methodology which is coming up is organ-on-chip, which is again a microchip, which is again a micro device. Which is about the size of a AA battery, and which again aims to simulate the physiological function of a organ or a process, and also part of physiological functions also tries to simulate mechanics of a process. So I will not get into the details of what these methods are and how they are designed and how they function. So these issues will be dealt in greater detail by some of the great speakers that we have in this webinar. So if you look at the global research in these areas, in the space of organoids and organ-on-chip, so you can see that the number of papers which have been published in these areas has increased exponentially in the last decade across the globe. So these are various countries, and you can see the growth, while the green is India, where the research is still in a nascent stage. So when we also looked at what are the model systems which are being used in India. So as you would expect, the primary model systems are, of course, mice and rat. But interestingly, computational models also come a close a third. But the organoids and organ-on-chip, which are the methodologies that we are talking about, they constitute about 0.3% of the model systems that are currently being used in India. But at this point, I would also mention the caveat of this pie chart. So we have measured research by number of publications, which is, of course, not a very sometimes not the correct parameter to measure the research which is happening in the country. So we also personally communicated with several researchers across the country to understand how many labs have are working in this space. And we found around 20 labs in India that have started working in this area, and about 5 startups and companies that are also currently working on organoids, various organoids on organ on chip. And this spurt has come in the last 5 years, where most of these labs and companies have started working the space in like I said, last 5 years. So while there has been great interest among the research community and startups to start working in this area, there has not been a concomitant spurt in the funding by either a government or private funding bodies. So we looked at the funding provided by DBT in last 5 years or last 10 years actually. So we picked DBT, which is the Department of Biotechnology, which is one of the major funding bodies of India. And also a lot of the information is available publicly, like all their grants which they've given and everything, it's all available. So we picked DBT for those two reasons. And again, we found that less than 2.2% of the research, which of all the grants that were funded in this area belonged to the projects that lie in this space. So there also needs to be a pick in the funding space towards these methodologies if we do need to encourage them. So as a center, we are also trying to understand how we can further enable these methodologies. So we have presently written 3 white papers on various non-animal and human relevant methodologies and trying to understand what are the challenges and what are the limitations. So some of the challenges in this space of organoid and organ-on-chip, which we found, was that one of the primary reasons is that most researchers are not aware that there are alternate methodologies that they can pursue. So most during while you're pursuing research, you come across with various animal models, but there is a lack of awareness and also training in how to handle, for example, iPSCs or how to design a chip. So that training or awareness is currently lacking. Another point is interdisciplinary collaborations. So many aspects of this research involves, for example, designing the biomaterial for the scaffolds, or designing the microfabrication of chip, or engineering of the scaffold which holds the three-dimensional tissue. So a lot of these aspects of this research involves collaborations between engineers, computational biologists, clinicians, and basic biologists. So currently there is that platform where different kinds of researchers can network and connect with each other. So that is currently lacking. Cost of reagents and instruments. So some of the reagents that are involved are, and some of the instruments such as 3D printer or bioreactor, the cost of those can be a significant inhibitor for some of the research labs. Funding, like I said, currently the government funding is extremely small percentage of the total funding, and the private funding in this space is almost not there. And regulatory approval. So a lot of the regulatory bodies, they also come with a huge dose of skepticism towards these new age methodologies, because they are not aware that these methodologies are also coming up, which can be more reflective of human biology. So many of the granting and regulatory bodies, they hold a lot of skepticism for these methodologies. So some of the ways we are trying to counter this is, for example, the lack of awareness and training, which is the first point which I mentioned. So we're having a lot of webinars and workshops in this area. And this webinar again forms a part of the capacity building venture, where we are trying to get more people to know about the exciting work that is happening in this area in India. We are also planning to design a curriculum for these methodologies, and we plan to get it into either the college level or at the level of for example, first or second year PhD students, where they're trying to decide which animal model to pick. Third way is again articles and reviews about these methodologies in both for both scientists and the non-scientific community to increase the awareness. For interdisciplinary collaborations, we plan to set up a network or a platform where different scientists can connect with each other, and this could be for both crosstalk and to set up collaborations. Cost of reagents and instruments. So while I was talking to some of the researchers, I also realized that many of them were actually making some of the reagents which are involved in their lab. And this was bringing down the cost tremendously. So there is potential for making most of the reagents that are involved or the instruments domestically in India. But because of the lack of communication between various, for example, industry and academia, these needs don't get answered. And we, being placed at Atal Incubation Center, we have the unique opportunity of being the bridge between startups, industry, and academia, so that where they can communicate with each other and these needs can be answered. Funding, we plan to collaborate with both government and funding private funding bodies to initiate funding in this space. And in near future, we also plan to provide partial fellowships to both PhDs and JRFs who are pursuing human relevant research. Regulatory approvals. So like I said, one of the main skepticism amongst the regulatory bodies and granting bodies is because of the lack of communication or the lack of awareness about the status of the development of these methodologies. So while these methodologies do come with certain limitations currently, but there is a lot of research which is happening, which is countering the limitations which are presently there. So those need to be communicated, and we need to have regular modes of engagement between academia and regulatory and funding bodies so that these latest advancements are communicated and discussed so that at the end when we are seeking regulatory approvals or grants, so at that time they also have a more clearer understanding of what these methodologies are about. So we are planning to organize multiple stakeholder meetings with regulators, industry, startups, and academia, so that all of us, and this needs to be a regular mode of engagement, so that hopefully in due course of time the skepticism towards new methodologies would evaporate, and it would be and there would be more scope for discussion and between different and crosstalk between the different stakeholders. So these are some of our initiatives which we plan to do which we are already doing and we plan to continue in the near future. And with this, I would like to end here. And if you want to know more about the Center for Predictive Human Model Systems and our initiatives, you can either go to our webpage or you can get in touch with me at my email, which is given here. And yeah, with this, I'll ask Shyam to come in and introduce our next speaker. Yeah. Thanks a lot. If there are any questions, you can write in the chat box and we'll, like Shyam will say, we'll kind of address those questions in the end. And yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Suraj, for giving us the information about
the overview and state of microphysiological
systems research in India.
So now
I would like to introduce our next speaker, which is Dr. Karishma Kaushik.
So I'll just introduce her. So she's a doctor as well as a doctorate. So and
that's one thing. So she has done her MBBS
and her
MD in clinical microbiology. And then she moved on to the US to pursue her PhD and also has worked there for a couple of years as an assistant professor of instructional biology.
Sir, not able to hear you properly.
Hello. Is it audible?
Okay, sir. Now audible.
Yeah. Thank you. So I'll just start over. So Dr. Karishma Kaushik is a MBBS doctor as well as she has done her MD from India. And then she has also moved on to the US and she has done her PhD and worked there for a couple of years. She has come back to India and has set up her lab at the Savitribai Phule Pune University. At the Institute for Bioinformatics and Biotechnology, and she runs the wound infection lab, and her lab is designed to study the complex chronic wound infection microenvironment and to enable precision-based personalized therapeutic approaches. So I welcome Dr. Karishma Kaushik, and I would ask her to start her presentation. हेलो,
Now you can hear me.
या मैं
Okay.
यही
So I
यही गो
think
है.
in the webinar mode, the first question we ask is, can you see me and can you hear me? Not how are you? That is what it has become. Anyway, welcome and thank you to AICC CMB and Surat and you, Sham, for the opportunity as well as Humane Society of India. So let's get into the meat of the matter. And there couldn't be a better way to segue from Surat's presentation to mine. We actually wrote an article together about human relevant research, but with a focus on infections. And we published it in Nature India. So I would urge you all to take a look at it, where we talk about tuberculosis, infections and cystic fibrosis, the Zika virus, and specifically why we need to move beyond mice and rats and look at developing organ-on-chip and organoid models. All right, so once you can take a look at that. But today I'll give you a maybe an overview and some exciting insights from the work that we are doing in our lab. All right, so I hope you're all ready for that. It's going to be a hopefully leading to a nice short story. All right, so show of hands in your own house. All of us have had a wound at some point in our life. I think so, right? Most often than not, our wounds have healed. They've left a scar, which we say are our, we flash off as our injuries or our pride, and we move on, right? But there are several individuals, several groups of conditions in which these wounds never heal, and they are known as non-healing wounds or chronic wounds. And an example is exactly what you see on the screen. You know, they become these festering breaches in the skin and the mucosa, which never heal. Now, this is a huge morbidity because it has social factors, there are economic factors because of inability to work. And this is a growing, huge issue for several reasons. The most important is the rise in diabetes, obesity, hypertension, all of which are factors that contribute to non-healing wounds. And we know that they're all on the rise in the world. So if you haven't heard of it, biofilms, my favorite thing in biology, biofilms are the single most important cause why wounds don't heal. So what are biofilms? They're basically these matrices of bacteria. So bacteria in like a mesh, in a mat, that infect tissue sites. Biofilms are not only found in wounds, they're found all over the body, but they're the most important reason why wounds become non-healing wounds. And this is some of work from people I've trained with, which shows that, you know, the blue is all the DAPI stained host cells, so that's the nuclei, and the red and green are aggregates of bacteria enmeshed in this host environment. And these are biofilms, these aggregates are biofilms. This is some of our work to recapitulate this biofilm state in vitro. And here we've shown it with two different kinds of bacteria, Pseudomonas aeruginosa and Staph aureus, which happen to be the most important, most widely prevalent wound pathogens that form biofilms. Here, Pseudomonas is stained with GFP and it's green, and Staph aureus is dotted as M. cherry and red. All right, so I set the stage. Let's move on a little bit. So what does this wound infection state really look like? What we see is on the surface is a wound bed. And the wound bed is your, you know, we think of it as our host components, right? So yes, there are host cells, which are your fibroblasts and keratinocytes, which are in a mesh. They interact very closely with the immune compartment lined with endothelial cells. So your neutrophils, macrophages, monocytes. So you can actually reduce the wound to a two-compartment system, the host and the immune component. And then what happens, where are these biofilms? These aggregates, as you saw in the earlier image, actually form on the wound bed. So they are enmeshed within the fibroblasts and the keratinocytes. Now, if this is clear, another aspect to a wound is that it's not a static environment. The wound is constantly bathed with, you know, wound exudate fluid, as you call it, wound fluid. And this exerts forces like, you know, shear stress and flow on the wound bed. So this is all building to understand that the wound bed is a far from a static environment. It's actually a hugely dynamic microsystem where our important aspect is the infection. So the biofilms interact closely with host cells, immune cells, wound milieu and chemical and biochemical factors, the matrix of the wound, which is your collagen, fibronectin, and a range of biophysical factors. So wanting to recapitulate a wound in vitro means we should at least think of all these factors and try and build a system with the capability to eventually include all these factors. So I hope you're agreeing with me as we move along. So this is some of our own analysis that we did when we started our lab. You know, it's important to understand what niche are we filling in our research. So if you look at it in the last, say, 40 years, there's been substantial work on wounds, especially because it became a big morbidity in the West because of different factors that I mentioned before. People have been studying treatment. People have been giving less attention to infection and even less attention to biofilms, which is where we are coming in. But also what I want to highlight here, given the focus of this platform, is look at the orangish-brown line, the model system. So this was a search done to have wounds plus biofilm plus models. And you can clearly see that it's far lagging behind. It's almost like there has been an impasse in the development of new models. So where are all the new people, the people developing, wound-relevant or wound-infection models relevant to humans? So the field has been stuck on a few standard model systems. Most widely is used is the in vivo, which is usually rats or mice. Now, like Surat correctly mentioned, mice are not humans and humans are not mice. But this is even more relevant in the context of wound infection and wound healing, is because the murine skin is much thinner and looser than human skin. And most importantly, the primary mode of healing in mice is contraction and not proliferation, which is what happens in humans. So when you see a wound, you see the wound bed filling up, right? And that is your granulation tissue. That's your proliferative host tissue. And this doesn't happen in mice. Now, it's in this proliferative tissue that the infection occurs, the biofilms occur. So all of this just leads to the question, is how relevant is it when we are culling mice at random and inflicting them with wounds, with the huge ethical issues that it entails, but it's just not relevant to humans. People have tried to reduce the ethical issues, enhance the reproducibility by doing these ex vivo platforms, which take porcine skin, pig skin, or human skin. The first thing that obviously this brings about is accessibility, especially in countries which are not North America and Europe. Access to porcine skin, human skin, and the ethical issues that it will involve. The other thing is maintaining these skins in the lab, human engineered skins, or engineered skin platforms in the lab. So these are definitely certain limitations. The big advantage is that they are more selective and you have more control than a mouse, and that you can parse out immune factors in these ex vivo systems, which certainly many of the in vitro systems don't have. Now, the simplest wound models are basically trying to simulate the wound fluid in a tube. So they add some blood, they add some serum, and they think it's a wound fluid. All right, you can grow bacteria, you can grow biofilms, you can study interspecies interactions. But based on what I've already told you, it's very clear that there is no host. Often there is no matrix. It's a static system. I mean, it doesn't simulate your mechanical flow and your shear stress. So people said, all right, maybe we can add host components. Let's take it to transverse. So transverse, as you can see, there are these two compartments. There's some communication between the compartments. So people use the upper chamber to have the host factors, the lower chamber for the immune components to study migration between the two chambers. Again, it's a static system, so there's no flow. And often the media is your standard cell culture media, and our wounds are not bathed in cell culture media. All right, so people said, let's try and do some flow. So they said, let's do drip reactors, which are these, platforms that shake like this, and you have biofilms growing on glass slides. So yes, there is some laminar flow. There is some shear stress. Where's the host? Where's the matrix? Right? Again, it's only a biofilm, and a biofilm is not a wound. All right, so the most complex so far has been the microfluidics. And my big, big problem with microfluidics for wound infections is it's micro, and our wounds are not micron-sized channels, right? So here you have these very hard to engineer, microfluidic channels. You grow cells, so there's host factors. You can grow, you can incorporate immune cells, so there are immune factors, and you can also grow bacteria. But the size, the dimensions, it's nowhere close. We don't get wounds of microfluidic size, right? So where does my lab come in? So we think we can provide a human relevant platform to reduce, if not eventually replace, animal testing. And we say, let's think big. Forget microfluidics. Let's go macrofluidics, all right? Because wounds are macro. So we had a student, Niharika and Jay, Niharika was from Berkeley and Jay is from an engineer from MIT. And we asked them to do this very simple task. We said, look at all the papers and look at the average dimensions of the wounds. And they were certainly not in microns. So we built a chip with a wound area that is very close to the average dimension we picked up. Of course, wounds vary in size. A bed sores will be much bigger than, ankle injuries. But we took some parameters to develop this size. So it's not micro, it's macro. It's a chip, meaning it's 3D printed. And we use a biocompatible polymer, PCL, for it. This is how it looks. This is Snehal, who works with us, holding it. So you can see it's a palm-sized physical device. 3D printed extremely low cost to achieve this. It has inlet and outlet channels, and the upper and the lower surfaces of the wound area are glass cover slips. What this does, it makes it extremely compatible for advanced microscopy, because we want to put everything under the confocal. We are biofilm people, right? So this makes it, this is just, the dimensions fit perfectly into the confocal slit. All right, so where do we get the mechanical factors? So Aniket from our institute found us asking for a low-cost peristaltic pump on Twitter and got in touch with us. So he built this in-house, cost-effective peristaltic pump, which has a motor, a rotor, and it's as small as a shoebox. That was the criteria we gave him. He said, how big can it be? I was like, go with shoebox, because that's what we need to fit in the CO2 incubator. So this system connects to the inlet of the wound chip, and the outlet is collecting the effluent. And as you can see, this entire system can fit in a shoebox, means it can fit in a CO2 incubator, because that's where we need to grow our host cells, right? So we'll get to that. But what this does is allow us to actually flow in fluid. So it resembles the exudate of fluid over the surface of the wound bed. And we can actually calculate the shear stress from the dimensions of this wound area. And when we did that, we find it comes pretty close to previously reported shear stresses. Rather, we engineered it such that it would pretty close to reported shear stresses in the wound bed. So this is now incorporating mechanical factors in the wound. And we eventually put this entire system under the confocal. All right. So this is something that we built pre-lockdown. It was moving very well. Lockdown happened, and okay, we are now going to get back on track. But the big question I had is, I'm like, okay, Vandana and Snehal, we're doing all this with this chip, but what are we going to flow? I mean, is DMEM going to be the solution to flow through this chip? So we said, let's try and develop an in vitro wound milieu, which is more than just serum and blood and peptone water, you know. So we have developed our in-house proprietary component, and I'm not releasing the exact concentrations here, but this is what it contains. It's primarily protein, because that is what wound exudate is, and it has wound matrix like collagen, fibronectin, fibrinogen, as well as some immune factors like lactoferrin and lactic acid, and these components and concentrations are reported in literature from clinical wound fluids. So the next question is, can our biofilms grow in this fluid, and how different is it from all the papers that have worked with standard lab media like Luria Bertini Broth, and you know, very reductionist wound models that use only bovine serum? So we went back to our two favorite pathogens, Pseudomonas, this is PAO1, M. cherry, and Staph aureus, which is SAGFP. And all right, in lab media, they grow very well. That's great. That's no big discovery that we've made. Now look what happens in bovine serum. They grow reasonably well. And most wound fluid papers, when they try to be human relevant, incorporate fetal serum, bovine serum. All right, again, it's an animal product, but you know, we can tackle only one problem at a time. So, and serum, I would think, is still less of an ethical concern than a whole animal, though I may have people who argue with me on that. So anyway, then we looked at our biomimetic wound fluid that we developed, and the results were, in spite of several repetitions, we found that Staph aureus never seemed to grow in it. It was only Pseudomonas that was growing. And this also ties into the clinical picture, where co-infected wounds, which are often polymicrobial with both these pathogens, Pseudomonas always outcompetes Staph. And this is something we never pick up in the lab when we do lab media work. Or for example, even with bovine serum. But the moment you add matrix, the moment you add some other factors, suddenly Pseudomonas is outcompeting Staph. So this was in planktonic mode, which, you know, resembles what initially when a few bacteria settle on the surface of the wound, and they're single cells. They're not yet biofilms. But wounds are often biofilms. I've said that. So what happens when we grow these pathogens as biofilms in this biomimic fluid? So if you look at blue is LB, great, Pseudomonas is doing well. It doesn't grow well in serum. Most studies are using serum. However, the moment we add our wound fluid components, which are more relevant to the exudate, suddenly Pseudomonas is forming very good biofilms. If you see, the difference between the serum and our wound fluid is all these factors, the matrix. So we think probably the matrix is supporting the microbial aggregates of Pseudomonas and supporting its growth. On the other hand, Staph aureus doesn't seem to be forming very good biofilms at all. And this measures total biomass. So this is live, dead, it measures everything. So again, it could point to the reason why Pseudomonas is outcompeting Staph. However, if you only assay metabolic activity, you find Staph, whatever little biofilm forms, is actually pretty metabolically active. They are live cells. So this could mean that this is why there is antimicrobial resistance, even though Staph aureus forms very thin and small biofilms. All right, and we definitely could find that when we grew them both together and we found, when we assayed the result compared to what we would expect if it was purely an additive effect of both the pathogens coming together and no interaction between the two, we found this to be vastly different. So also our interspecies interactions were better appreciated, I would say, when you add a more human relevant wound fluid as opposed to reductionist FBS or completely irrelevant LB media. So we got that going, and this is a good story shaping up. And this is my favorite piece of data that Snehal and Vandana have produced. So we used the wound fluid with our other media to look at how does the biofilm architecture appear. And this is advanced confocal microscopy. We thank the NCL Venture Center for giving us enormous time for this. And we are basically looking at the whole biofilm. This is not a part of the biofilm. It's almost like you're appreciating the entire biofilm on a wound. And if you see, our biomimetic wound fluid forms very thin biofilms. Pseudomonas and staph, in this case staph, forms very, very thin biofilms. So one thing is certain, when you look at the 80 micron thick LB and the 45 micron thick FBS, and then you look at our wound fluid staph biofilm, is we are grossly overestimating the biofilm formed when we use these media. And which is why we always see this huge antimicrobial resistance in the lab, which may not always translate to clinical. Because as you saw in our first slide, biofilms are not mats in the wound, but they are other aggregates. So definitely our wound fluid with our matrix and other factors are showing these differences, which is very encouraging. And we want to take this story to completion as soon as we get back. And my third and final piece to this is, all right, so we have the chip. We know what we are going to flow through. But where is the wound bed? So the wound bed is fibroblasts and keratinocytes. And as it so happens, biology doesn't make life easy for biologists. Growing these two cell types is a huge challenge. The reason is, while they survive very well together in the human body, in the lab, fibroblasts need serum. And as luck would have it, keratinocytes don't want serum. They prefer to be under low serum or serum-free conditions. So how do we get them to grow? So previous approaches have added, everything, including the kitchen sink water, you know, pituitary hormones, insulin, various growth factors. Now this is tedious. This is hugely demanding in terms of cost and acquiring these reagents. And Surath, you mentioned the challenge of acquiring reagents relevant for our work in India. Another thing that they do is try and layer them. So they grow fibroblasts with serum, take the media, then they add keratinocytes without serum. But this is not how the wound bed is. This might be how the wound bed is at the edges, but not in the mesh. Here, the cells are closely entangled within each other. So we did some work where we tried to overcome this using commercially available components. So we had our commercially available media, which was either fibroblast growth media, keratinocyte growth media, or basic medium supplemented with relevant growth supplements. And we found that we could reduce the concentration of serum to up to 1-2%, where they both grew well. We were able to overcome this discrepancy in serum requirements. Layering was fine. We expected this to do well. But what was great is we were even able to do this with co-seeding. That means you add both cell types simultaneously to mimic this central part of the wound bed. And as you can see, keratinocytes are forming these beautiful clusters sheathed in a bed of spindle-shaped fibroblasts. Absolutely gorgeous to look at. And I can definitely say that this is going to be some good work that we're putting out. We already have a preprint on this. Okay, so the wound bed grew, but can we do something with that wound bed? I mean, what use is that if the cells are not migrating and resembling wound closure? So we tested this. Snehal found a way to create a very nice scratch. Simple scratch, all right. And we looked over time, the cells were migrating from the periphery, closing in on the wound. Both cells were proliferating and fibroblasts were primarily responsible for the migration component. And we saw that the wound could close within 24 to 48 hours. So the cells could grow, they could also proliferate, and they could also migrate. So where do we want to take all of this? These are all great stories on their own, but where we want to take this is make this compatible device where we have the wound bed grown on the wound area, flowing in under wound-relevant shear stress, our wound fluid. So inlet, outlet, effluent can be used for downstream biochemical analysis. We want to try and grow biofilms on the surface of this wound bed. And we have some very promising results, which we haven't been able to redo only because of lockdown, where we looked at fibroblasts co-cultured with Pseudomonas, and we were actually able to see these microbial aggregates very similar to what I showed you in slide 1 in the fibroblast bed. So we're going to try and recapitulate this and we've been funded to do exactly this now. So this is where we look at this composite system. We can create a wound by moving trypsin in, or we can use some mechanical physical factors. Where do we see this platform in the scheme of things? While we don't think we are yet at a regulatory stage to replace animal testing, we believe our platform can be in the preclinical development pipeline, where we are way better than our reductionist in vitro models, and yet don't have to only use animal models. So we hope to offer this as a service, a platform where, you know, researchers having novel therapeutic approaches, antimicrobial approaches, can send their chemicals to us, we can test them and kind of give a go, no-go decision. You know, do we need to do this animal testing? Because the regulatory agencies believe, I don't, that animal testing is the current mandate for moving into clinical work. But we believe we can kind of place ourselves in that system for now. So that's the story so far. As you can see, I'm very excited about it and I get carried away when I'm talking about my own work. This is us. So we've been grateful for the funding from DVT, both Ramaswamy and IYBA, and we have funds from STPU as well. And we have a wonderful group who are very, very motivated, and Snehal and Vandana have held fort on these projects. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and I'm open to questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Kaushik, for this insightful lecture on your work, which is happening at your lab. With regard to questions, I would ask everyone to post their questions in the chat box, so that after Dr. Deepak Modi also speaks, we can then take all the questions together, and then individually we can address it to the speakers and they can reply to it. We will move on to the question and answer section. So if there are any more questions, if people would like to ask, I request them to put their questions in the chat box. Now I request Dr. Surat, Dr. Karishma and Dr. Modi to switch on their video so that the questions can be asked. So let's move on with the question and answer section. The first question is for Dr. Surat. And the question is from, once again.
So the question. Most of the questions in the chat box, Ram. I think one question which I didn't answer was,
okay.
So I think there was one question which I didn't answer. So that was regarding whether there is regulatory approval, I think I'm just trying to find the question, by Sanjeev Kumar Gupta, like what is the worldwide use on use of alternatives regarding the regulatory views. So I think that's one question which I didn't answer. So others, I think I've answered in the chat box. So regarding this question, so I would like to say, so currently even worldwide, we are not at this stage, like the regulatory approval is not there. For example, that you cannot currently negate the animal model stage, like you can't perform an experiment on organoid or organ on chip and surpass the animal testing stage. So we are not at that stage yet. But there is a lot of initiatives and collaborative ventures between federal agencies and regulatory bodies to further validate these systems. For example, in US, the tissue chip testing centers have been started in a joint collaboration between NIH and FDA and other federal agencies, which are basically for validating these chip platforms for various organs independently. And there are also several such initiatives in, for example, EU and UK, where in collaboration with regulatory agencies and federal agencies, such initiatives have been set up, which further validate and establish the relevance of these model systems. So so having full breadth of that information will hopefully in a few years down the line, we'll be at the stage where we can move on, like independently test these, use these model systems and then go to clinical stages finally. But yeah, so we are at the stage where in collaboration with regulatory bodies and, for example, government, several initiatives have been set up to have like full data on validating these model systems, like both organoids or organ on chip. So yeah, I hope I've answered. And if there are any follow-up questions, you can also mail my email ID, so you can follow up. I think rest of the questions I have kind of answered on the chat box. So if there are anything else, I'll be happy to take.
Thank you, Dr. Surat. We'll move on. So there are a few questions for Dr. Karishma Kaushik. I'll read them out. So this is a question from Dr. Ashwini. So as we know, MMPs have an important cyclic role in chronic wounds, and there are different dominant MMPs in different wounds. So can the role of MMPs be stimulated on chip models? So that's a question from Dr. Ashwini.
So Dr. Ashwini, as well as Shyam Venkat asked a similar question on MMPs.
Yeah,
yes, absolutely. So we can put MMP9, for example, it's well known to shape the wound environment. Its effect on biofilms has not been well studied. We can definitely incorporate that into the wound fluid or into our wound area. We have thought, we have tried. The issue is MMPs are extremely expensive to purchase off the shelf. And I need to be funded on a separate grant. Or AICCCMB needs to step in. So no. So that is the only limiting factor, actually. But that can be added into the wound area. Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you. There's another question from Sijini Basak. In spite of wounds being macro-sized, can we replace macro-scale wound healing devices with micro-scale ones? Will a less bulky device be more advantageous or not over a macro-scale one?
No, we don't think so. One thing is, with micro-scale, it's not a wound bed. It is just a cell-lined tube, in my opinion. It's not a wound bed. The second big issue is, how do you create a wound in a micro-scale device? Here, we actually have a proliferative wound bed where we can create a wound by adding chemicals or a physical injury. With a micro scale, it's not possible to do so. So this is the whole thing that led us to the macro device, actually. Yes.
Yeah, thank you. There's another question. Since blood is one of the main body fluids, how does one recapitulate blood composition in these wound studies?
Wound exudate does have blood in it, but the major component is serum in the blood. If you look at it, what really impacts the wound in the blood is the serum and the immune cells. Right? So that is what we are putting into our wound fluid, not the red blood cells.
Yeah. Thank you. There's also another question from the Facebook comment section. So I'll just read it out to you. It really seems hopeful to replace or reduce the reductionist in vitro models for clinical purpose in future. As we're talking about the concerns over the host cells and ECM in wound bed in fluidic chips, is it possible to integrate organoid culture with your lab-made chip for more relevance? So this is a question from Pratiti on Facebook Live.
I mean, if you see, our wound bed is an organoid only in some form, you know, it's a two-cell type organoid. But if you want to go by the classic thing of what, like Deepak showed, the spheroid kind of organoid, then yes, you can put that in the wound area, right? That it just depends on what you're trying to mimic, where the wound bed is not really an organoid.
Yeah, there's another question from the Facebook comments. It says, why did you choose only two bacteria and what was the concentration of matrix in the outlet?
Matrix in the outlet, I'm not sure I got that question, but two bacteria is because they are the most common wound pathogen. Okay. They are almost always present. We are trying to add commensals to see their role in the wound infection process. We've not yet got there, but these are the two most common. That's why. Two.
So I think Dr. Karishma, that's all with the question that is to you. Now I'll move on to Dr. Deepak and like to post him a few questions which our participants have put up in the chat box. So the first question is from Sanjeev Kumar Gupta. And the question is, which is the best diagnostic marker for preterm birth?
So that's been something, a holy grail for almost all of us. And a lot of us have been chasing it. As of today, there are no great markers for preterm births. Different people have tried CRPs and IL-6 and inflammatory cytokines because it is believed that it is increase in cytokines which is causing preterm births. None of them have been really very great. So unfortunately, with this being such a bad problem, we don't have great markers for early diagnosis of preterm births.
Right, sir. There's another question from Dr. Ashwini, and his question is, can the mechanical characteristics of spiral arteries also be mimicked in the engineering model?
We can only mimic up to the shape right now, because now we have started facing challenges. As Karishma rightly said, that these are currently, these all these monolayer two types of cells is growing in single kind of a condition, and these don't really mimic the 3D organizations which we want to look at. And then when we started talking to these engineers, then we realized that, you know, our imagination versus their imaginations are very, very different. So right now, I think we are trying to take a approach which is like a hybrid, not completely macro, like what Karishma is talking about, but not completely micro, which is because we think macro is very hard to handle, because then cost of reagents, cost of things which you want to push in becomes very, very high. Micro, we can't manipulate a lot of things. So mechanical, except probably for flow, we will not be able to mimic many of the mechanical conditions for the spiral arteries.
Thank you, sir. There's also another question from Dr. Brinda. She says, would it be possible to produce human endometrial tissues from hospitals for comparison with the lab-grown organoids in order to make this more human relevant as opposed to comparing them with the mice?
Ideally, that would be an ideal condition, but imagine that the endometrial tissue is not a static thing. It is responsive to hormones. Now, I need extremely timed tissues which are coming from a woman in a follicular phase, a luteal phase, a menstrual phase, and nobody's going to give me biopsies for that. I mean, we cannot subject a woman to endometrial biopsy, which is highly invasive and requires a lot of technical expertise. Although ethics committees have been very generous enough to allow that, but personally, I don't think, and we have enough data to say that the animal and the human endometrial tissues are fairly relevant. So I'd like to do my mechanistic studies on the mouse model, and then try to see how many of them are getting mimicked to the human. Because studying fetal-maternal interface, so we have a lot of collaborations with IVF clinics and the hospitals, but getting timed endometrial tissues, and specifically when the embryo is implanting, ethically not permissible, and I would not want to get into that.
Yes, sir. Yeah, another question is from Sachin G. Swami. And the question is, when you are using microfluidic device to culture different cell types, how are you setting up ECM?
So currently, that's again a challenge. We are only using matrix gels and we are making organoids. In vivo, we are just coating these the surfaces with different kinds of matrix gels like fibronectin or vitronectins to see which of the cells grow appropriately. But that we have not even completely reached that stage. We are right now at the designing stage of the microfluidic devices. So that's the next challenge which we all think we will get into.
Right, sir. And one last question is from Vaishnavi Balasubramaniam. What is the media composition you use to maybe perform these experiments?
So currently everything, we have tried to adapt our cell lines with DMEM HAMS-F12 with 10% FBS. But I don't think we'll be able to sustain that any longer, because some of our cells just don't like DMEM. So our hope is that when we derive new cell lines, we derive them using extremely uniform media, so that at least that one component, because, you know, these have been grown with some medias 30, 40 years ago. And, you know, over the period, medias have changed and some cells just don't like to grow in some media. So that's another challenge which we are facing. So, you know, it looks very nice when we start talking about this. Okay, engineers are very great to make these devices, but we as biologists face completely different sets of challenges. And I'm sure, Karishma, you have faced this, that just getting those two cells getting together in one dish is
exactly. Sleepless nights.
Absolutely.
Yeah, there's another question. Maybe this question can be answered by all three of you. Your take on this question. So the question is, how do you compare holistic nature of a natural system versus a organ on chip? So that's a question by Sanjeev Kumar. I would request if everyone can chip in their views on this question.
Karishma, you go, because you're more closer there than me. And okay. I would add on after.
No, of course. Honest answer, absolutely cannot recapitulate 100%. But we are better than animal models and closer than reductionist approaches. But we can't, definitely not 100%.
Right.
So I call them all as complementary models. We should not call them as alternates also. I don't think that's right. We should rather call them as complementary. And the simpler the system, easier it is to make the organ on chip and organoid. But as you get to more and more complex systems, like what me and Karishma spoke about, it gets more and more difficult, because I'm sure now we are still wanting immune cells in your system, immune cells in my system, then immune cells are of different kinds, differentiate them under different conditions, and then you can't have immune system because your cells are of a completely different genotype and your immune cells are coming from someone else. So these are practical challenges, and I don't think they'll ever reach there. They will reach to some extent. So it's best to call them as complementary models to each other. We cannot get away with any of them.
Continuing on those lines, I think the idea is not to form one so-called alternate model which is going to replace human biology, but then maybe, like he said, a combination of methods which could maybe answer the final question. Like, for example, even with to take the current example of COVID, like currently there is no single animal model which can capture all the complexities. Like there's some animal models will show some facets, and like no single animal model is able to capture the, for example, the severe form of the disease. So some aspects are captured by certain animal models. So currently it's not that one animal model is able to capture all the facets of a pathophysiology anyway. So the idea is not to look at one replacement which is going to be like the all answer or the mega answer, but then maybe look at how we can find a combinatorial solution to finally get at and how we can derive an answer by combining different approaches and finally get an answer. So I think this way
that it depends on the question. For example, in placenta, if the question is to look at transplacental drug transport, then don't bother about anything else. Then just push things in the maternal channel, check in the paternal channel, because that's where everything is going to happen. But if you're talking of something from endometrial cells to placental cells, then obviously you need a whole lot of devices. So it all depends on a spiral artery remodeling. It's not just endothelial cells and trophoblast cells, but it also requires macrophages. So then I can't use the other placenta on chip device. So based on the question, one would want to use the right kind of model. So right now the idea should be that make different kinds of a reductionist model, which is slightly better over the planar cultures, but not completely a complex system like we started with in our lab. So that's probably the way to go.
Yeah, thank you all. There's another question to Dr. Karishma. In the wound, there is a pH difference as compared to the body. How would you achieve that using your model system? I think that's a good question. Yeah.
I answered that in the chat. So a wound fluid actually has a pH very close to the wound exudate. Again, like, you know, you have women in different stages of menstruation, so endometrium will change. Wounds can be diabetic wounds, infected wounds, what kind of pathogen causing the infection. So there's no one answer to pH also. Again. But healing wound pH is what we tried to recapitulate in our wound fluid, and we managed that. Yes.
Right. There's another question to Dr. Modi. For organoids or organ on chip, most challenging thing is vascularization and supply of blood, which they think is very crucial. So how can one achieve this, which is near to impossible?
Yeah, so in organoid, it's still not possible because we have been trying to co-culture 2-3 different cell types in endometrial or the trophectodermal organoids. And it's very difficult to, not just difficult, I think it's nearly impossible. I'm yet to come across a paper where they have been able to do that. But at least in the organ-on-chip, it's slightly, organ-on-chip, it's slightly easy because now you can create those neat channels and then layer them with endothelial cells and then co-culture the other cells. So in the placenta-on-chip model, on one side, we grow the endothelium. Then we have a membrane over. Then we have the extracellular matrix. And then we put the trophectodermal cell. So this is like kind of the fetal endothelium. And then the maternal endothelium, which is exposed to the trophectodermal cells. And on the other side of the channel, you grow maternal endothelial cells. So you can kind of achieve it. But yes, again, it's very, very challenging.
There's another question to Dr. Karishma. To make these studies more realistic, how can we correlate any underlying comorbidities of patients to the wound bed, considering the study deals with chronic wounds and even healing? Depends on a huge array of cofactors and parameters.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So, for example, diabetic wounds is the next thing we want to try and mimic in our wound platform or wound fluid. We can add blood sugar. We can add sugar depending on what blood sugar levels we want to recap. We have tried this. We have done a little bit of work on this. So this is I would say the most accessible example sugar for diabetes. Other wounds, hypertensive wounds, venous wounds, they will be much more challenging, you know, because there is no chemical component that can be mimicking that state. Mm. Yes.
Right. Yeah, there's another question to Dr. Deepak. Is it possible to study menstrual disorders through these organoids? And is it possible to multiplex these organ on chips? So,
People have tried on the endometrial organoids to mimic menstruation, and they have been able to achieve it. At least a sloughing of the endometrial glands have been achieved. Apoptosis of the cells have been achieved. We can simply by changing the levels of estrogen and progesterone, you can mimic it to an extent, but not completely. Menstrual disorders, what people are trying is, instead of actually mimicking them on vitro, we can take endometrial cells from these menstrual disorders and put them on the organoid devices and study them further. So there are organoids for mimicking PCOS, endometrium in PCOS. There are organoids for mimicking endometrium in women with endometriosis. So yes, it is possible. Multiplexing is still a challenge. At max, we are able to achieve two cell types. Getting anything more than that, I'm not too sure whether we will be able to get there unless some magic or revolution happens in industry. And that's where we want industry to step in. And that's what my question to Surat was, that you know, how many industries in India are actually even thinking of using these models, or you know, wanting to partner with us. So we were trying to look for an industry partner for our organ on chip device, and we had a tough time getting convincing somebody that, hey, at least Imprint Grand needs an industry partner, and there is just no one in this country. So then we have to look at startups, and I feel miserable to rope in startups in these kinds of conditions, because these are extremely risky projects where you're not sure even you'll be able to achieve 10-20% of what you are proposing. And then if a startup invests a whole lot of time there, and if it's a failed project, it's a bad thing. And I really hate myself for doing that. But then unfortunately, there are no in this country who want it. So I think as a platform, we should, you know, encourage industries, and these things should be developed as equal partnership model, rather than, you know, wait in the industries, wait for the academic institutes to develop something. They wait till everything is shown nice and they say, hello, now we will start using them. So I think if the industries start pitching in from the beginning, then we would then only it would pace up very quickly. Otherwise, it's going to be still a challenge.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Dr. Karishma. Thank you, Dr. Deepak. And thank you, Dr. Surat, for patiently answering the questions and also delivering this lecture. So now I would like to request Dr. Madhu, if he's there. Dr. Madhu?
Yeah.
Yeah. So Dr. Madhu is the CEO of Atal Incubation Center CCMB. So I'd just like to ask him to say a few words.
Thank you, Shyam. Thank you, all of you, especially panelists, for setting aside a time for us to speak about your work, and also, you know, tell us about the power of organoids in finding alternate models. I've become wiser in last 1 hour, definitely, because though we keep talking about it with Surat, but that's not this is more technical, and then really, really appreciate your time. Thank you very much. And I'm actually last 5 minutes I was thinking, because my the role is mostly supportive role. So I have you can de-abbreviate my name as CEO, as ceremonial executive officer at this point of time, because it's all the thing that Surat and Shyam has done it. Thank you, Surat, for that. And this project in CPHMS is kind of being operated by AIC CCMB. AIC CCMB is part of CCMB. And as you probably know, that we have a kind of very serious engagement with cell culture and tissue culture for a long time, stem cell work. So we feel natural about this tissue-based models for replacement of alternate models of PKPD studies for toxicologies. It would be because this is new science, I think more people should be involved, and these kind of webinars will be extremely useful for interesting people into this game. At CCMB, we feel, as I said, it's natural for most of the staff here. So if among the listeners, among the participants, if they want to get into it in a very, in a more substantial way, they should get in touch with Surat, and we have several plans. Probably we could get together and make these things on floor and then start things, make things happening rather than, you know, talking about them. I mean, we can talk for a beginning to bring some traction, but beyond that, we have to put the things on floor. So we would really want to get there, and these kind of things would be extremely useful. And thank you again very much for all your time. Thank you, viewers. Please get back to Surat if anything of the today's talk excites you. And that's from me. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words, and I would thank all the panelists who have taken the time and presented their work on this webinar today. And I would also thank all the participants on Zoom as well as on Facebook who have patiently listened to the webinar and gathered the information. Having said that, there is a link to the feedback form which is on the chat box, so people can just fill in it, and so we ensure that we will keep in touch, and we will also be holding further webinars on these lines in the future. So we also expect participation from your side. So having said this, I again thank all the panelists, Dr. Modi, Dr. Karishma Kaushik, and Dr. Surat for sharing their information with us. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Yeah.